Well, good morning, everyone, and can I welcome you to the sixth meeting of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. I'd invite members to turn off their mobile phones, please. And today we have apologies from David Torrens, who is unable to attend the meeting this morning, and he has submitted his apologies. In his place, we have George Adam, who is attending the meeting as the substitute member, and we welcome George to this committee today. So I'd now invite George Adam, in accordance with Section 3 of the Code of Conduct, to declare any relevant interests.
I don't have any relevant interests, but I refer you to my declared interests in the Parliamentary's website.
Right. Thanks very much, George. Welcome. We now move to Agenda Item 2, which is about taking decisions in private, and it's proposed that the committee hold item 7 in private. This will be an opportunity for the committee to discuss the evidence it has heard from Scottish Government officials who are with us today earlier in the meeting on the student loans regulations. Does the committee agree to consider item 7 in private?
Agreed.
Thanks very much. We'll now move to item 3. Which is the Education Student Loan Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016, consideration thereof. And I'd like to welcome to the committee John Patterson, who's the Divisional Solicitor for Food, Children, Education, Health and Social Care in the Scottish Government's Legal Directorate. Good morning. I would also like to welcome Afsi Barikat, who's the Solicitor on Food, Children, Education, Health and Social Care in the Scottish Government Legal Directorate as well, and Leah Fitzgerald, who is the Policy Manager at Student Support and Participation Team for the Directorate for Advanced Learning and Science in the Scottish Government, and they are here today to answer the questions we have on the Education Student Loan Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016. And so a very warm welcome to our committee today, and thank you for taking the time to come and hopefully provide us with the information we're seeking. I'm going to start with the first question, which is, can you please explain to the committee the chronology of events that led you to bring forward these regulations?
Sure. The regulations are really, they begin with a letter that we received from the Equality and Human Rights Commission in November 2014, which asked whether the Scottish Government had considered its policy in this area, particularly in light of the Equality Act 2010 and the public sector equality duty. Off the back of that letter, policy colleagues undertook a policy review which began with a quality impact assessment. I don't know whether, Leah, you want to say anything more about the timescales for the quality impact assessment?
Yeah, the first part of the review that we undertook was the quality impact assessment, and from that we took a number of options which we put to ministers, and while that review was ongoing, we had notification that there was a judicial review. So for part of the review process, we had the review and the judicial review, which were running in parallel. We came up with our recommendations for ministers, but because of the judicial review, then that affected the timing of the public announcement of the review. But the review concluded at the end of 2015, and then the judicial review was heard in May 2016.
And would you like to talk a little bit about the Court of Sessions judgment or ruling?
That's probably something I'm better placed to do. The judgment relates to our particular case of somebody who was over 55 and seeking to have a maintenance loan provided to them. The findings of the court in that judgment are that the regulations as they currently stand were not compatible with ECHR insofar as they set a cut-off date, an age limit of 55. We have considered that judgment and accept the findings of the judgment. That said, there are some aspects of the reasoning in the judgment in relation to which we reserve our position.
Yes, carry on. Yes.
I think perhaps an example of that might be helpful. The test to be applied in this type of case is a matter which was recently considered by the Supreme Court. At the Supreme Court, two of the justices of the Supreme Court felt that one test should be applied, two that another test should be applied, and the final one didn't express a view on which test. So, you know, it's an aspect of the law which I think it's fair to say is still open to debate, given that the Supreme Court itself hasn't definitively ruled on it.
However, the judgment stands because the Scottish Government has chosen not to challenge it.
Absolutely.
And so we are where we are. So we move forward from that position.
Yes.
Right, that's very helpful as a starting point. I'm now going to invite Monica Lennon to bring forward the next question, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. As I understand it, these regulations are subject to the negative procedure made under powers conferred by the Education Scotland Act 1980. And it's in your written response to the legal advisor's questions that these regulations are not a direct response to the court's judgment in the Elizabeth Hunter v. the Student Awards Agency for Scotland and the Scottish Minister's case. But the existence of that judgment gives rise to a need for remedial action to address the issue of incompatibility, which the ECHR has identified. Accordingly, was any consideration given to using the remedial order process under the Convention Rights Compliance Scotland Act 2001?
It would always be I think I'm right in saying this, it would always be the Scottish Government's practice to use legislation appropriate to a particular subject matter where that's possible, and only rely on a Convention Rights Compliance Order where that's necessary. So in the circumstances here, then we were able, within the time limits that we have, to make legislation under the Education Scotland Act. And I suggest that's preferable to, for example, using the urgent procedure under the Convention Rights Compliance Act. I think it'd be fair to say that given that we had powers to make the necessary changes by using the Education Act, then we didn't give specific consideration to using the Convention Rights Compliance Order, because our first consideration would always be to use the legislation designed for dealing with a particular subject policy area, so in this case the Education Act. Does that make sense?
Just to clarify then, was it considered?
It would be a second stage of consideration if the Education Act didn't allow us to make legislation within the time frame necessary. I think it's fair to say it was considered as a backup in the event that the court hadn't given us time in which to make an order. In that case, we would have had to use Convention Rights Compliance Order using the urgent procedure, but that wasn't necessary.
Okay.
So a kind of initial consideration was given to it, but not a detailed consideration because we didn't get to a stage where it was a real, it was something that we were likely to have to do.
So it's still an option open to you then?
Yeah, it would still be an option open to the government, yes.
Anything further you wish to add, Monica?
Again, just to quickly clarify, I think you, in your first response, said that it wasn't necessary. Could you maybe just explain that a little more?
Of course. So when approaching any piece of legislation, any piece of secondary legislation, then we're looking at the powers that we have, and depending on the particular policy that's to be delivered, then there might be more than one option in terms of a power open to Scottish ministers. So, for example, here, then you would say, well, one option was to make an order under the Education Scotland Act, which is our regulations under the Education Scotland Act, which is what we've done. Another option would have been a Convention Rights Compliance Order. And in the initial consideration of that, the early consideration of that, then you'd be saying, well, what are the advantages and disadvantages of each? As well as whether you have legislation which is open to you in relation to a particular subject area, you'd also be looking at things like how long it will take for the process to be completed, whether there are any likely barriers to one approach or another, you know, risks rather than definitive barriers. And on that consideration, then, as I said before, the first step will be to say, well, is there a legislative option within this policy area, i.e. can we use the Act that relates to this particular policy area? And it would only be in circumstances, normally only be in circumstances where you can't, that you'd say, all right, well, we're really in territory to use something else. So, for example, if it's European law, then if we didn't have something in our domestic legislation which related to, say, food, then we would use the European Communities Act in order to make the legislation, because it kind of gives us a general power to make legislation in that area. Likewise, here, where we're talking about human rights, then if we'd concluded that we didn't have a suitable power in the Education Act, then we would have gone on to look more closely at the Convention Rights Compliance Act as a vehicle for making the necessary legislation.
Okay, thanks very much. Well, that leads nicely into the next question, which I'm asking you. And the judgment indicates that decisions as to how the incompatibility identified ought to be corrected must be left to the Scottish Parliament to be guided by the Scottish ministers. Can you explain why it's considered that bringing forward regulations subject to the negative procedure, or indeed how regulations subject to the negative procedure affords the Parliament sufficient opportunity to be fully involved in the correction of the defect as required by the court? Why was the Parliament not consulted in advance of laying these regulations, given the existence of the judgment, which is quite specific, although I don't have it in front of me, but the nature of the judgment is that I think the government, guided by Scottish ministers, should take this through Parliament. Well, of all the instruments available, of all the ways of bringing forward legislation, the negative instrument is the one least likely to involve Parliament.
I think the first thing to say is that our intended approach here was disclosed to the court, and the court made no adverse comment in relation to it. In relation to the choice of procedure, it's not so much a choice of procedure here. And the choice of procedure was made, and it was made some time ago when the relevant section in the Education Scotland Act was enacted. And at that point, the procedure in relation to that provision was set out. What we have alighted on is not a particular procedure, but rather a particular power for ministers to make statutory provision. It so happens that that particular power in section 73F of the 1980 Act is subject to the negative procedure.
Okay, thank you very much. We'll now move to the next question, which is Stuart.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Where a measure has the capacity to interfere with convention rights, it must be established that it pursues a legitimate aim in the public interest. What legitimate aims do these regulations pursue?
The EQIA states that the aim of the policy is part of a wider policy to prioritise support in the form of tuition fee grants, bursaries and living cost loans for students entering the labour market, and ensuring that students taking out a loan have a reasonable chance to repay some or all of that loan prior to retirement. And we submit that that is the legitimate aim in this case.
Okay. And also, paragraphs 23 to 26 of the government's written response to the legal advisers' questions set out the objective basis for choosing an age limit of 60. Can you expand on those paragraphs? And why is the choice of age 60 over any other age considered to strike a proportionate balance between the various interests involved?
I'll pass this to my colleague Leah in a moment. But I think from a legal perspective, the point I would like to make is that the case law is clear that bright line rules such as an age limit of 80 or an age limit of 40 are legitimate and can be justified. And in that context, it's recognised that government has to set a limit at some point when establishing systems, and so whilst it might on the face of it appear odd that somebody who's 60 can obtain a maintenance loan, somebody who's 61 can't, and maybe there's only a short time difference between their birthdays. That approach has been afforded legitimacy by the courts. And so with that preliminary comment, I'll pass it to Leah.
When we undertook the review, we did look at a number of options, so keeping the age cap at 55 or increasing it, and we looked at the evidence. So student loans are paid back only when you are in employment, so to have a reasonable chance of the loan being paid back, we have to be satisfied that people will be in employment for a period of time. So when you look at the labour market stats, for example, only 8.2% of people are in employment over the age of 65, but when you look at the income bracket, the age bracket below that, 50 to 64, it's 68.6% who are in employment. So we looked at things like the labour stats, we looked at the change in the landscape, acknowledging that the increase in the state pension age and the retirement age meant that people were working longer. We also had to balance it out, because if you take out a student loan when you are 18, you'll be paying that back for 35 years, whereas if you take it out, the older you are, the less time you have to pay it back. So it has to be fair for everybody. There were also issues raised when this policy was looked at a few years ago with regards to the interaction between the state pension and student loans, and there were concerns raised by the DWP that this would be double funding if people were in receipt of loans and state pensions. So, and we looked at what the position was as well in the rest of the UK. So it was a number of factors that informed each of the options that we put up to ministers, and 60 was the one that was decided upon.
Just to play devil's advocate, to go back to your point there regarding the length of time to repay, to increase it to 60, that would then cut down the opportunity for somebody to get into the labour market and then repay. So why was the 55 considered to be no longer acceptable?
When 55 was set, and that was back in 1999, it was a very different landscape. So I think it's quite clear that with the state pension age, it's increasing and it's due to continue to increase and will be reviewed every 5 years. And the fact that the labour market stats over the years are showing that more and more people are remaining in employment. So it was seen as an appropriate time to increase it, to acknowledge these factors, but it was also done on the proviso that this policy would continue to be reviewed, so that there's a commitment made that it will be looked at again as part of a student support review that will be starting shortly, and that was something that the Equality Impact said, that this has to continue to be reviewed to ensure that it is still an appropriate age.
Okay. And the family convener, Lady Scott, in her judgment, contended that she was not satisfied that there was no less intrusive measure than a blanket cut-off available. Given that the approach you have taken in these regulations again applies a blanket cut-off date by reference to a person's age, why do you believe that this approach does not unjustifiably discriminate in terms of a right to education, and were alternative approaches to the one set set out in these regulations considered?
I think it's worth noting that both Wales and Northern Ireland have an age limit of 60, which implies that they couldn't identify a suitable alternative. England has a markedly different system with means-tested bursary for full-time students over 60. But again, their system has a change at 60. In terms of what Lady Scott said in her judgment, she did also say that she recognised the legitimacy of having a cut-off. If you give me one moment, I'll just refer to the judgment. Yeah. She said at paragraph 55, a cut-off or a blanket rule which interferes with convention rights may well be reasonable, for example, when an objective basis is shown that it will reduce the overall impact on resources. But the cut-off shown, which gives rise to the discriminatory effect on the petitioner, must be rationally connected to the aim or objective and be a proportionate way of achieving it. Lines drawn still require to be examined as to whether they are proportionate, and such examination is not to substitute the court's drawing of the line, but to assess whether where it has been drawn is justified. A cut-off on the basis of age is not justifiable unless it can be shown to be rationally connected to the legitimate aim of the decision-maker or regulations involved. If I can just reverse that final sentence, it would say, a cut-off on the basis of age is justifiable if it can be shown to be rationally connected to the legitimate aim of the decision-maker or regulations involved. So, I was...
How is it rationally justifiable when also in Lady Scott's judgment she said that manifestly, without the age of 55 was without reasonable foundation? That's pretty strong words for so how then is the age of 60 with foundation?
Okay, so the age of 60 is with foundation because when you look at the aim is not simply to provide student support at any cost. The aim is to provide student support in a sustainable way. And one of the considerations in relation to a maintenance loan that's been provided, is will that maintenance loan or part of it ever be repaid? In the context of somebody who is younger, then there's a longer period for repayment. In the context of somebody who's over 60, there's a shorter period of repayment up until state pension age. Now, state pension age need not necessarily be the point at which somebody stops working, but nevertheless, I think as Leah explained, as people get older, less people work, and of the people who do work, less of them earn more than 17,355. Sorry, less of them earn more than 17,355, which is the point at which you start to repay the maintenance loan.
I think if I can just add that.
Yes.
Probably relevant here in understanding how the Outer House could reach that conclusion in relation to an age limit of 55, and how the Scottish Government can reach a different conclusion in relation to an age limit of 60, pointing out that the Outer House didn't have before it all of the material that the Scottish Government has considered in assessing the age limit of 60. The Outer House commented in its judgment that there is no evidence available as to the intention behind that particular cut-off, so this was the cut-off of 55. It did not have the equality impact assessment before it that the Scottish Government has considered. And
1 second, the equality impact assessment is with regard to 55-year-olds, is it not? Rather than 60-year-olds.
That is correct. The equality impact assessment was...
So how is that relevant?
It's relevant, the Scottish Government considers, because the equality impact assessment had
has
a view
been
made
to... for two different ages, but it's rolled into one.
Well, it was looking at the equality implications of having an age limit. I think throughout the equality impact assessment, it refers to an upper age limit of 55 or above. So some of the conclusions that it comes to are capable of... encapsulating a higher age limit, and indeed the inequality implications of a higher age limit are lesser, we would consider, because it in fact increases access to
as someone who's well over 60, I would say that my equalities, my rights in terms of equalities are just as important to me as I get older than when I'm younger.
Indeed, and I think the Scottish Government of course would agree with that view.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, I didn't really mean to stop you when you were in mid-floor explaining how this equalities impact assessment, which is carried out specifically for 55-year-olds, is relevant to the evidence you are now saying or providing as part of the evidence for a cut-off age of 60.
It's connected with this point that the Outer House didn't have before it all of the evidence that the Scottish Government had before it. And part of the reason for that is that the Outer House was specifically considering the legitimacy of the age limit of 55 in the context of that particular petitioner's circumstances. Indeed, the Outer House stated that it did not find it helpful to consider a document containing financial modelling which was carried out after the petitioner herself was denied a student loan. So there were some analysis that was done that the Outer House didn't find relevant to its conclusions, but that analysis the Scottish Government considered to take a thorough view of the proportionality and the justification of an age limit of 60.
So was the Scottish Government prevented then from giving evidence to the Court of Session that might otherwise have changed their view? I might have otherwise allowed them to come to a different view. I mean, it does sound a little to me as if you're in denial about...
That's not the case. I don't mean to imply that the court prevented the Scottish Government from offering its evidence. It simply didn't find that evidence to be relevant, which is...
courts do, yes. And so why is it relevant now, then?
Perhaps I can clarify. The court didn't find the financial modelling... relevant to that particular case, and whilst I can't say definitively why it didn't, it did note that it didn't find financial modelling which had been prepared after the determination in relation to Ms. Hunter had been made to be helpful. So it might be implied that what the court was saying was that the government wasn't entitled to rely on information that it prepared after the event in relation to that particular person. That information and the information in the equality impact assessment, neither of which were, the equality impact assessment wasn't available to the court at all, but both those pieces of information were available to the government when reaching its decision in relation to this regulation, and both were taken into account.
Yes. I suppose our major concern here is that if human rights are being breached at 55, then we need, before we can proceed as a committee, to welcome this piece of legislation, a real understanding, a real justification as to how you feel that this proposed new order or instrument is ECHR compatible, given the foregoing. And at the moment, I'm still struggling to see how or if you've demonstrated that the cut-off age of 60 will be acceptable to a further court challenge. I mean, you have cited the fact that in England and Wales and in Ireland, the age of 60 is as it is, but it's not been subject to legal challenge either. And what we're seeking to avoid is another petition of the Court of Session, notwithstanding the cut-off age having been moved to 60, but that again being found to not be compliant, as I'm sure you understand, but not yet happy with the explanation you've given us.
Okay. Perhaps I can take things back a little bit and explore, first of all, the relevant test. There's two potential tests here. The first is whether the measure taken by the Scottish Government and passed through the Parliament is manifestly without reasonable foundation. And the other test is whether, weighing all the relevant factors, the measure adopted achieves a fair or proportionate balance between the public interest being promoted and the other interests involved. So, as I mentioned earlier, the Supreme Court has considered which of those two tests would apply in this kind of case and has not reached a conclusion. We submit that the test of whether the measure is manifestly without reasonable foundation is the appropriate test. But nevertheless, I'll take you through the other closer test on the basis that is that gives a closer scrutiny. So, the first question then is: does the Education Student Loans Scotland Amendment Regulations have a legitimate aim? As I described to you, the aim of these regulations is to prioritise support in the form of tuition fees, grants, bursaries and living cost loans for students entering the labour market, and ensuring that students taking out a loan have a reasonable chance to repay some or all of that loan prior to retirement. And the latter part of that is very much about the sustainability of the scheme. So, is that a legitimate aim? Well, we'd submit that it is a legitimate aim to have a scheme that's sustainable, that you know, can carry on from year to year. The next question then would be, is the measure rationally connected to that objective of prioritising support for students entering the labour market and ensuring that students taking out a loan have a reasonable chance to repay it prior to stopping work? Again, we would submit that it is, because of the fact that it sets a cap on eligibility for student maintenance loans of 60, it does have a rational connection with ensuring that the system is sustainable by helping to ensure that loans are repaid in whole or in part. As I mentioned before, once people stop being part of the PAYE system, once they stop being employed, then the maintenance loan repayments are no longer collected. The next question would be, could a less intrusive measure have been used without unacceptably compromising achievement of the objective? As I mentioned before, Wales and Northern Ireland have apparently found no suitable alternative. I understand that we have identified no alternative that we thought that was suitable and which wouldn't unacceptably compromise achievement of the objective, achievement of having a sustainable system. And then, does the measure strike a fair balance? Well, we would submit that it does. Given the wider considerations about the affordability of the student finance system and the decision of the government to focus on providing free tuition for first-degree students, which benefits those of all ages, having an age cap is proportionate and justifiable. A balance has to be achieved. And if you look at the alternatives, well, you know, an alternative would be to have no age limit, for example, but that would clearly cost more, and it would also put somebody who's 25 and entering college in a very different position in terms of repayment to somebody who's 75. That might be thought to be to not strike a fair balance in relation to the person who's 25, who will have to pay for the system, as opposed to the person who's 75 who won't. So I hope that further explanation is useful to you.
It is very helpful. Monica, when you go. Monica Lennon.
Thank you. I just wanted to pick up on one point, because we're going back to the judgment, and we have to make that connection between the legitimate aim of the decision maker, in this case the Scottish Government. A couple of times we've heard today that I suppose that the test is to deliver student support in a sustainable way. And the word sustainable can mean different things to different people. Given that definition is so key to what we're looking at today, could you say a little bit more about what exactly the Scottish Government means when it talks about delivering student support in a sustainable way?
Yes, I think that's probably something that's more for my colleagues than me.
What we mean by sustainable is it has to be something that's fair and affordable in the medium to long term. So it has to, student loans have what's called the RAB charge. So they have a cost involved to them. So at the moment, it's about 31%. So for every £100 of student loan that is loaned out, it costs the government about £31. So it's loans, we don't ever get the full amount back. So we have to make sure that when we're loaning out money, we are getting a reasonable amount of loan back so that we can continue to carry on the system year after year. So that's one of the considerations when we look at something that is sustainable in the long term, is the amount of loan that is being paid out. Are we going to get sufficient amount of loan back? And the less loan that students pay back, then the higher the cost to the government to loan that money out initially.
Okay, on you go, Monica, and then we'll come to Rachel.
If I may, just a couple more points. So in terms of the test that is applied to gauge if someone has the ability to pay back, is that purely in relation to how many years they may have in the labour market? Is it based on that projection alone?
Student loans are deducted from income, so you have to be earning over a certain amount of money. So It is, because it's a PEY system, you have to be satisfied that somebody is going to be not only working for a reasonable amount of years to pay some of that back, but working at a reasonable income level to pay back student loan.
Okay, and just last question. We heard earlier that no suitable alternatives were identified, or there were alternatives, but they were considered to be unsuitable. Can we maybe hear a little bit about what those alternatives were?
There have been other models of student loan before that. Prior to 1999, there was a mortgage-style loan that was paid back based on people paying fixed amounts of money, and we moved to this system because it was believed to be a fairer system to students. This system is a system that all students pay, so you would really have two options. If you wanted to do something different for older people, you would either have to have two systems running in parallel, which could potentially have equality issues if you had people of a certain age paying back loans in a certain way and older people doing it. So I think to have a system that is fair to all people and to be sustainable and to also be something that's not too onerous to administer, because student loans they're repaid by students and they're collected by a student loan company, they're collected by HMRC. So any change in system would have implications for HMRC and the student loan company. So there are other, I think it's also fair to say as well that student loans are not the only part of the support package. So if you're over 60, you wouldn't be eligible for a student loan, but you can still get free tuition, you can still get bursary, discretionary funds, additional living cost grants. So it is only a part of the student support package. So when you're looking at the loans, you also have to look at the rest of the support package, and there is other support out there for people of that age.
Thank you. Rachel, if you'd like to come.
You've explained to some extent the process of consideration that led you to conclude that the cut-off for eligibility to apply for student loan should be set at 60. It is noted that there was no consultation to inform these regulations, but was any consultation undertaken as part of the equality impact assessment?
Yes, we consulted with a number of stakeholders, including Age Concern, the NUS, and other charities concerned with older people.
Okay, and do you feel that that was satisfactory to come to your conclusion for the cut-off?
Yes, the EQIA showed that following discussions with these groups, there was little to no evidence to suggest that this had been an issue. Both Age Concern and the NUS said it had never been raised by them as a concern by any of their members, and it wasn't something that they had on their radar as an issue.
Okay. Thank you. And question 8, George.
Yes, I would just like to ask about the quality impact assessment. The fact that you said earlier on that it was in tandem with the Court of Session ruling, is that correct? Was that the same timeline?
Quality impact assessment was carried out before the judicial review, so the quality impact was the first part of the review, and then the review was carried on in tandem with the judicial review. They overlapped.
So that was based on the previous policy, which was 55 cut-off date, which the Court of Session found discriminatory then?
It took 55 as a starting point to say, was it legitimate to have an age cap? And as the age cap at that time was 55, then that was what it looked at, but it went wider than the age cap of 55 and made references throughout to the fact that a higher age cap would help with equalities. And I think you can, as you read through it, you can kind of see that what is applicable to 55 is also applicable as you go up through the age cap.
The equality impact assessment, you said it happened, it came to just before the court's ruling, so there was no way that the court could actually get access to this information?
It's not something that was before the court, that's correct.
Uh-huh. So do you believe it would have made had any impact on the court's ruling?
I'd be
who knows what the court of session is going to say.
Absolutely, absolutely.
You know, so what are the impacts, do you believe, of the court's ruling on the quality impact assessments?
I think what the court of session made clear was that it didn't feel that there was a strong evidential basis for the age of 55. When 55 was brought in, there was no Equality Act and no equality impact assessments, and one had not been carried out since that date. So we now have a quality impact assessment. We now have up-to-date evidence. So I think we have answered that part of it. The quality impact has now been carried out. And it, as I said, it didn't pick up any particular issues with having an age cap. So we think on that basis that having an age cap of 60 is a fair reflection of the quality impact assessment.
Can I just ask a very practical question, convener? Basically, you know, in the real world, it's very difficult for somebody 55, 60 to try and get a mortgage for a 20, 25 years. Is this not a kind of similar idea that you're basically looking for a way for the loan to be repaid?
Yes, we are. And as that is something that will be monitored as this goes through. What is the impact of it, and what is the cost, and how much are we actually getting repaid?
Thanks.
Yes, I mean, I think that really gets to the rub of it. And you've talked about the importance of sustainability to the Scottish Government in terms of repayment. And just as a layperson, I don't know how important the sustainability element. It's obviously important to a government, any government, that they have ability to carry on the scheme. But how important is it to people in terms of their human rights? Or if sustainability is denying those who might otherwise apply for such a grant or loan, then, and in so doing, denying them their human rights, I just wonder how interested, to be frank, the courts would be in whether it's sustainable or not, if fundamentally their human rights are still being denied.
Accepting that the legitimate aim is to provide a sustainable system, as I would submit a court would be likely to do, then you wouldn't get to the stage of denying somebody their human rights, because their human rights would be being respected, whilst at the same time they would not necessarily be eligible for a maintenance loan. I mean, take perhaps an example going the other way. If you look at the free bus pass scheme, which applies to over 60s, then it's not an infringement of my human rights that I don't have that. It's just something that my human rights don't extend to providing it to me.
Okay. Stuart, did you want to come in?
One final question from me, the convener. Just it's in terms of the sustainability. Now, I'm not sure if you will actually have an answer for this, but in terms of the 55 age and the 60 age, what are the financial implications, or what is the financial difference to the student loans company and also to the Scottish Government in terms of the two different ages?
The modelling we carried out, and I should say that it's a very hard thing to predict, because we know the number of students who are in full-time higher education at the moment that fall within that age group, but we don't know what their household incomes are, and the loan is to some extent means tested. And we don't know how many people who are part-time students may decide to go full-time if additional support was made available, or people who are not currently considering going into education would decide to go into education. So we can only kind of come up with a sort of rough prediction based on what we know at the moment, and kind of looking at the overall student population and basically saying if there was no difference between the number of students who entered higher education and how much could it potentially be if kind of a lot more people in that age band decided to enter it. So the modelling that we've done suggested that raising the age cap could cost between 0.7 million and 16.5 million. And the difference in those figures takes into account the potential household incomes of the students and also the number of students that could potentially enter education at full-time level.
Okay.
Right, thank you. So given you've said there's a declining demand as people get older, I mean, have you considered no age cap at all, but nonetheless the liability would still remain with, or is that just
if you had
a sensible question to be asking?
If you had no age cap at all, then you would be loaning out money to people that you knew would not be in a position to potentially pay that back. And then that speaks to equalities for younger people, because equalities are obviously across all ages. It's not just about being equal to older people. So I think there would be a risk that people who were entering education at 18, knowing that they were having to pay that back, would say, well, wait a minute, if you're 80, you're basically de facto getting a bursary, and this isn't fair because you're being treated differently from me in practice.
It's an interesting point, and I can see why there's others have found it difficult to come to terms with. Anyway, unless any other colleagues have got anything further to add, can I thank you very much for taking the time and the trouble to come and talk to us today. And we're very grateful for what you've told us, and thank you for your help. Thanks very much. I'll just pause briefly to allow our guests to leave. Right. And we move now to agenda item 4, which is consideration of instruments subject to affirmative procedure. No points have been raised by our legal advisers on the following affirmative instruments: the draft Scottish Local Government Elections Amendment Number 2, Order 2016, or the draft Maximum Number of Judges Scotland Order 2016, or the draft Sheriff Court Simple Procedure Limits on Award of Expenses Order 2016. Is the committee content with these instruments?
Content.
Thank you. Agenda item 5 is the consideration of instruments subject to negative procedure. The first instrument is the Acquisition of Land Rate of Interest After Entry Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016, SSI 2016/258. The regulations were laid before Parliament on the 8th of September and come into force on the 30th of September 2016. They do not respect the requirement that at least 28 days should elapse between the laying of an instrument which is subject to the negative procedure and the coming into force of that instrument. As regards its interest in the Scottish Government's decision to proceed in this manner, the committee may wish to find the failure to comply with Section 28 to be acceptable in the circumstances. The reasons for doing so are outlined by the Scottish Government Planning and Architecture Division in their letter to the presiding officer of the 8th of September 2016, supplemented by a written response to the committee. So, does the committee wish to draw the regulation to the attention of the Parliament under reporting ground J, as the instrument fails to comply with the requirements of Section 28.2 of the Interpretation and Legislative Reform Scotland Act 2010. Thank you. Yes. Right. My clerk has just pointed out to me that I should have said, do we find the government's failure to comply to be acceptable in the circumstances? And, of course, that is what we were doing. So thank you for that agreement, and thank you for pointing out the error of my ways. So we now move to the other instruments on our agenda, subject to negative procedure. No points have been raised by our legal advisers on the following instruments: the Food Hygiene Scotland Amendment Regulation 2016 SSI 2016/260, or Smoke Control Areas Exempted Fireplaces Scotland Revocation Order 2016 SSI 2016/292, or the Smoke Control Areas Authorised Fuels Scotland Revocation Regulations 2016 SSI 2016/293. Is the committee content with these instruments?
Content.
Thank you. Agenda item 6 is the consideration of instruments not subject to any parliamentary procedure. There are a number of instruments before us today giving effect to proposals by the Local Government Boundary Commission for Scotland in 25 local government areas. No points have been raised by our legal advisers on these instruments. The first of these instruments is the Aberdeen City Electoral Arrangements Order SSI 2016/265. The other councils for which there are instruments on this matter in alphabetical order are Aberdeenshire, Angus, Clackmannanshire, Dumfries and Galloway, City of Edinburgh, East Ayrshire, East Dumbartonshire, East Lothian, East Renfrewshire, Falkirk, Fife, Glasgow City, Highland, Inverclyde, Midlothian, Moray, North Ayrshire, North Lanarkshire, Perth and Kinross, Renfrewshire, South Ayrshire, South Lanarkshire, Stirling and West Dumbartonshire. There is one other instrument on which no points have been raised by our legal advisers, and that is the Courts Reform Scotland Act 2014, Commencement Number 7, Transitional and Saving Provisions Order 2016, SSI 2016/291C26. So, is the committee content with these mini instruments? Many thanks. So that concludes the committee's public business for today, and we'll now move into private session.